Dr. Martin Mosola doesn't need any introduction. He's a world-famous linguist from Max Planck Institute for Evolution Anthropology in Leipzig, in Mexico. We are very glad and very happy that he accepted our invitation and came to Olomouc to our philosophical faculty. You are not here for my words, but for words of Professor Haspelmann, so start and enjoy the
Thank you very much for the invitation. Can you hear me? Is the microphone on or does it work properly? Okay. So thank you for the invitation. It's my first time in Olomouc, so my first time in Moravia, in this part of the Czech Republic, and I'm enjoying myself. It's a splendid city. It reminds me of Bamberg in northern Bavaria, also kind of old Baroque city with a cathedral, very small but a nice university. And here it's really amazing to see all the activity in linguistics that I hadn't been aware of, that in June there's this big Olinco conference that I only learned about yesterday. So yeah, and then all these interesting people who are passing through, and hopefully in the future also a lot of interesting work coming out directly from Olomouc. So I work on language typology mostly, and mostly on smaller languages worldwide comparison. But I assume that most of you don't want to hear so much about Amazonian languages or languages of the Pacific and so on. So I will talk about a few rather general topics that I think have an impact on everyone, really, everyone who studies language structure. And this is sort of something that I've learned from looking at lots of languages. In the second lecture this afternoon, I will also take a closer look at some more exotic languages, but today we'll start with the general topic of grammatical form frequency correspondences. So we have these 90 minutes or so, or 85 minutes, and at any point, please, if you feel that you don't understand something, feel free to just raise your hand and ask a question. I think interactive mode would be nice. I mean, this is a fairly big audience, so it may not work, but don't feel ashamed if there's something that you would like to ask about. So I start with the contrast between language use and language system. Ever since Saussure 1916, the Cours de Linguistique Générale, this has been a prominent topic. So Saussure distinguished between langue as a language structure and parole as language use, and Chomsky famously distinguished between competence as language structure and performance as language use. More or less the same distinction, except that de Saussure emphasized more the conventions shared by the speech community, whereas Chomsky focused more on the mental state of an individual. So we have this this contrast, and I think it's important to understand it. But how does this relate to the idea that language is an instrument for communication? And how can we understand this instrument through language use? That's a kind of question. When we have an instrument that's made by humans, like a hammer, which is specifically designed for drawing a nail into a wall, then it's clear. The humans had the goal in mind and they designed the hammer. But how can language be shaped? So intelligence design is probably something that we want to rule out. So it was not God directly who made our language structure. Somehow it was the people, but how did that happen? So that's kind of my question here. In the 20th century, in the famous structuralist and generative approaches, somehow the connection between language use and language system was not considered at all. And language structure was considered quite independently. So in structuralism, the main focus is on understanding language as a coherent abstract system, un système où tout se tient, as Antoine Meillet put it. In generative linguistics, language structure is understood as a cognitive system constrained by the properties of the innate language faculty. So in both cases, the connection to language use is de-emphasized or is even ignored. And de Saussure has this nice metaphor, which I like quoting. He says, on peut comparer la langue à une symphonie. We can compare langue, the language system, to a symphony dont la réalité est indépendante de la manière dont on l'exécute. So whose reality is independent of the way in which the symphony is performed. Les fautes que peuvent commettre les musiciens qui la jouent ne compromettent nullement cette réalité. So even if the symphony players commit errors, that doesn't affect the symphony. The symphony is independent, so the symphony is the language system. And then, of course, in speech, we often make errors. We make speech errors, we have hesitation phenomena, and so on. So Saussure emphasized the independence and said the language system is sort of here regardless of the performance. And similarly, Chomsky, in his first book, when discussing this famous colorless green ideas Sleep Furiously, he says, evidently, one's ability to produce and recognize grammatical utterances is not based on notions of statistical approximation and the like. So he dismisses statistical approaches to language, counting of corpora. This is something that some people had been doing already at that time, although it was not as easy as it is now. And he says that the competence of the native speaker cannot be related to that. So these are just two emblematic sentences, just for really a big picture, to give you an idea of where I want to situate myself. So I would like to go beyond those two approaches and really consider language structure together with language use. So I have written here that this is the 21st century approach in general. Of course, I don't know what the 21st century will bring, but it's actually quite plausible that that will be the direction in which linguists will move, simply because language use is so much more easily accessible to us. You know, we can mine huge corpora of data, you know, web corpora and spoken corpora. You know, there's so many videos online that one can relatively easily make use of. And in the 20th century, it was just much more difficult to study language use. So it was more convenient, perhaps, to just focus on the abstract system. So I think simply the technological development will lead to a greater role of the study of language use. So there's no denying that language structure is a coherent abstract system to some extent. So Saussure was right. There's also no question that language structure is constrained by the properties of the innate language faculty. Absolutely, Chomsky is right. You know, whenever Chomsky says, you know, UG is just trivial, you know, he's right. It's trivial to some extent. However, language structure is also shaped by the needs of language use to a very large extent. That's what I would like to argue. And so there's no disagreement with Chomsky here. It's just a question which factor contributes which part of the explanation of language structure. So one thing that's also been long known is that language structure is somewhat flexible or variable. So we have different varieties. You know, all of us have different varieties at our disposal. You know, not only if we are multi-dialectal, if we speak perhaps a kind of Moravian plus also standard Czech plus maybe also several varieties of some other languages like more colloquial English perhaps and as standard English needed for academic prose. So there's all these possibilities. speakers are not rigidly limited by conventions. The conventions are very strong, but we can always go beyond them a little bit, violate them. Now, if a convention violation is picked up by others, then the violation becomes a new convention, and then we have language change. And it's important to understand that innovation and diffusion, so language change, is not a random process. Innovations respond to usage preferences. Diffusion probably also responds to usage preferences. So Bill Croft and I had some argument about this about 15 years ago. It's not so easy to find evidence. Language change is rather difficult to study, and I'm not going to say much about it. But on the whole, there's really no reason to think that language change should be very different from other change processes in large populations, as they have been studied in particular in evolutionary biology. So the idea that we get mutations and innovations, which can even be random, plus then selection, which corresponds to diffusion and propagation, that is applicable also to culture, is now a fairly widespread idea, and quite a few linguists have tried to push this idea, and I think they're basically on the right track. So the idea is that language structures are adapted to the needs of the speakers in much the same way as biological organisms are adapted to their ecological niches. So this is by way of, you know, very general background. And now let's look at one particular way in which this is true. And this is the correspondence between frequency and language structure. And we see this first very clearly and totally uncontroversially in the case of the length of words. So we have car versus helicopter, horse versus hippopotamus, liver versus belly button, word versus clitic, mouse versus CPU, star versus planet. So in all these cases, monosyllabic item on the left-hand side contrasts with the polysyllabic item on the right-hand side. And it's clear, it has to do with frequency. The most frequent words are the shorter ones, and those on the right-hand side are the less frequent words. So frequency increase can apparently lead to shortening of words, and or frequency decrease can lead to lengthening of words. So what exactly the causal factors is, I'll get to that a bit later. But just, you know, look at these examples and, you know, just think of any other minimal pair, and it's sort of clear that there is this correspondence. I mean, it may even apply to place names. You know, why is Prague monosyllabic and Olomouc has three syllables? You know, I don't think it's an accident. You know, if a place name of a big city or so, you know, it can be shorter. It's used more frequently. I mean, it's more complicated, but still, I think there is some grain of truth. I don't know of anyone who has studied these things, but I think it's not far-fetched at all to claim this. Okay, but I'm interested in grammar. I'm a grammarian, syntactician, and morphologist, and we'll get to syntax especially this afternoon, but also in a moment. But let's start with very simple morphology. Singular and plural marking. Singulars tend to be zero marked, whereas plurals tend to be overtly marked by some marker. So we have not only English house and houses, and Czech dům and domy, lesgian, that's the Caucasian language that I studied in the 1990s, sew and sewer, Swahili mtu versus watu, hausa zomo versus zomaye. So, you know, these are just three unfamiliar languages as examples of a worldwide trend. This really is very thoroughgoing, and it was observed by Joseph Greenberg in 1963. There is no language in which the plural does not have some non-zero allomorphs, whereas there are languages in which the singular is expressed only by zero. The dual and the trial are almost never expressed only by zero. So, you know, Greenberg, 1963, was a great foundational work of modern worldwide typology and universals research. And so he saw this very clearly. It's expressed in a somewhat roundabout way, but it's a very, really a very general tendency. In general, languages don't have specific singular markers, but they may have. So in Swahili, you see this M marker. That's really a singular marker, and the plural marker is there. So you might say, well, tend to be zero. So in Swahili, the singular is not zero, but it's interesting. The plural is still longer. It consists of two segments, whereas the singular consists of a single segment. So one might say that there's a relationship even here. Okay, so Greenberg in 1963 didn't have an explanation for this. So he just stated the generalization, and you know, he also wasn't looking for an explanation. You know, he said, look, we have so many things that we can state that seem to be true of all languages. So what's the explanation? Well, in 1966, Greenberg wrote a short book where he hinted at an explanation, but he didn't really push it. The explanation has to do with frequency. So let's look at some corpus data. Very simple, you know, British National Corpus. There's a nice website at Brigham Young University where you can just type these into a search field, type house into it, you get 49,000 type houses, you get about 10,000. Bear versus bears, person versus persons, hare versus hares. Well, it was bird versus birds. It seems to be an exception. Birds, you see, is more frequent than bird. But overall, all singulars taken together is 3.2 million words. All plurals taken together is 1.5 million words. So overall, singulars are more than twice as common as plurals in the British National Corpus of English. We go to the National Corpus of Russian, which also has a very nice website. I know there's also a National Corpus of Czech, and I haven't checked it out. Maybe also has a very nice website, and you can check it out, and I bet you you will find very, very similar trends. These things are really similar in all languages. So in Russian, again, the singulars overall, the National Corpus of Russian is kind of much bigger than the British National Corpus, but the proportions are rather similar, so over twice as many singulars as plurals, and house, twice as frequent as houses, bear, much more frequent than bears, persons, more frequent than person, hare, and with birds in Russian, it's about equal. Well, the singular is a little more frequent than the plural, but it's a similar trend. The asymmetry is not as strong with bird as in the other cases. So there seems to be something perhaps about bird. I won't go much into it. You know, just to say that, well, yes, there may be exceptions, but the overall trend is very strong. Okay? So it's a very simple example. Now it gets a little more complicated. Nominative and accusative. Just like singulars tend to be zero and plurals tend to be overt, nominatives tend to be zero, whereas accusatives are overtly marked. And again, Greenberg noted this in 1963. Where there's a case system, the only case which ever has only zero allomorphs is the one, and now it gets really complicated, which includes among its meaning that of the subject of the intransitive verb. And that's the nominative, right? So the nominative is the one that has only zero allomorphs in some languages. Now, he wanted to generalize also for the ergative absolutive alignment systems, because Greenberg was aware that not all languages have an accusative case. So in some languages, the same case that's used for the subject of the intransitive verb is also used for the object of the transitive verb. But don't let's worry about this. Let's just look at these few languages here. So in Latin, we have mensa, mensam, with an overt accusative. Hungarian, ember, embert, with an overt accusative. German, mensch, menschen, Okay, and now here, the columns are not right. So in English we have he and him, or in Spanish Juan a Juan, right? So languages, if they have a distinction between nominative and accusative, tend to have an overt accusative and a zero nominative. Of course, we may also have this type Marcos Marcom in Latin in a different declension pattern. There's an overt nominative and an overt accusative. That's a little bit like here, these cases where there's an overt singular marker, also perhaps in Hausa, maybe the O can count as a singular marker. So this is a kind of exception, but it's not a strong exception in that it's not the other way around. You know, it's not that only the nominative is marked and the accusative is unmarked. So again, let's look at some frequency data. In the British National Corpus, we can only look at the pronouns, but it's quite striking. He occurs 640,000 times, him just 153,000 times, they and them, also very striking difference, or between we and us. With she and her, the difference is not so striking, maybe because her can also be used as a possessive pronoun, right? You can also say her book, not just I met her. So here, I use the most primitive corpus search to give these figures, and I think if they were refined more, then they would be even more striking. Yeah, Jeff? I don't know. I didn't look that up, perhaps because I was worried that the I has just a single letter and cannot be found or so. It doesn't matter. It's the predictions are the same for all these. So, you know, if you find some really striking counterexample, then I run into problems, you know. I make these really very, very general predictions that are very easy to test. That's for me is this the virtue of this approach, and more people should be doing this. So I, you know, whenever I'm invited, I say, well, you just let's do these kinds of things because they're so easy. In general, people who study corpora don't do these easy things because they find it too trivial. And of course, you know, if they look at a particular language, then it is trivial. So it's non-trivial from my perspective, which is a typological perspective where I try to find things that are general across all languages, and not so many things are general across all languages, right? There's so many language-particular details that have no counterparts even in the next language down the road. So as somebody who looks at the big picture, I'm also happy about some trivial generalizations. And I think it's worth keeping them in mind, even though most of you may probably be working just on one language or be not really be interested in so many languages worldwide. It's still interesting. And I can assure you these generalizations that Greenberg proposed back in 1963, they were confirmed again and again and again. And they're really solid knowledge of contemporary comparative linguistics. Yeah?
Would you expect that when, let's say, the language would have zero morpheme for nominative, that it will influence the frequency? Because then you can, I would not be so sure that the pronoun in nominative in Czech would be that frequent, given that we are prodrop language. So in many contexts, the subject will be unexpressed.
Right, yes, that is clearly a factor that needs to be taken into account. So if one, you know, if there are independent reasons for not using the nominative, then the bets are off, so to speak. So the idea is that if the nominative and accusative have sort of equal chance of occurring, right? Now, of course, if the nominative in a typical language with argument marking, subject argument marking on the verb, you don't need the nominative, and then the nominative will only be used for emphasis. So you can say that in a language like Czech or in Italian with lui, for example, you know, that's used for emphasis, so it has an additional meaning in a way, and so it wouldn't count then. So you, one should, of course, compare things that are equal in meaning, including pragmatic meaning like focusing. But in such cases, one might even expect the opposite. You know, that perhaps the nominative is longer than, right, if it occurs less frequently. But of course, then the accusative can also be stressed. These things, you know, once one gets into the details, they can be complicated. So here I present the simpler picture, but I'm happy to discuss more complex cases. Sure. Okay, so just some examples from the National Corpus of Russian, because in Russian all the nouns are coded for nominative and accusative. So it's fairly easy to see that for most of the nouns, or at least for, well, let's say for the human ones, at least the nominative is more frequent than the accusative. For the non-human ones, it's actually not so clear. So kniga, for example, the book word is used a bit more frequently in the accusative. Mashina, kar, is also used more frequently in the accusative, and ruka, hand, is used much more frequently in the accusative. So what's going on here? Is that a counterexample to the prediction? Well, here I haven't given the overall number of nominative and accusative. I think overall the nominative is more frequent than the accusative. I don't quite remember. But one also has to take into account, of course, that the accusative is then sometimes used with prepositions. And this generalization really applies only to those cases which are used as subjects and objects. So the use of the object case after prepositions in the Indo-European languages is actually unusual. So one might expect, therefore, that in the Indo-European languages, where the accusative is also used after the prepositions, and it's sort of highly frequent, that the nominative-accusative asymmetry is not so strong. And maybe that actually correlates with the fact that, you know, nominative-accusative is not so asymmetric in Indo-European sometimes, right? So the Russian kniga knigu, I think Czech is similar. It's not so clear. Okay, but this is already getting into the complications, and I wanted to stick to the simpler things. And actually, the complication that I wanted to focus on is that often there is an asymmetry between animate and inanimate, or human and non-human nouns. And this is, again, something that can be seen to correlate with frequency. Because there's another universal that Greenberg didn't talk about that was discovered only in the 1980s. When not all patient NPs have accusative marking, then those that are high on the person, animacy, indefinite scales tend to be accusative marked. So it's a higher person, the first and second, that have a stronger tendency to be accusative marked, the higher animacy, so the humans, and the higher definiteness, so the definite and specific ones. So we see this in Spanish, for example. The director is looking for the car, el carro, without accusative, the dog, el perro, without the accusative, but his son, that would be a su hijo, right? Or in Russian, and again, I think Czech is similar, Misha saw the house, dom, without the accusative marker, but the cat, kota, and brata. So in Russian, it's humans and animals. In Spanish, it's only the humans. And then in some other languages, it's all of them. So Hungarian, for example. So Janusz saw the child, saw the dog, saw the film. So we have this kind of scale where Hungarian has accusative marking throughout, where Russian has it only for the humans and animals, and of course only in some declension patterns, so that's a complication that I'm omitting here. Spanish has it only for the humans, and Vietnamese has object marking in no cases. So we have this nice scale. That's an important typological discovery of the 1980s. And it also works with definites, so pronouns have a stronger tendency to have accusative markings. So in English, it's only the pronouns. Layla saw him. And once you have Layla saw Yusuf, well, there's no accusative marking, or saw the boy or a boy. In older German, it's interesting, we have the accusative marking on pronouns and also on proper nouns. So there was a special accusative marking just preserved for proper nouns, but then the other nouns didn't have it, except for a few exceptions, all among the animates. And then in Persian, again, the accusative marking is used for pronouns, proper nouns, and definite nouns, but not for indefinite nouns. So you would say Hassan Ura Deed, or Hassan Ali Ra Deed, or Hassan Kitab Ra Deed, but not for the book, but Hassan saw a book, it's just Hassan Kitab Deed. So again, we have the scale from pronoun via proper noun, definite noun, specific noun, to non-specific noun. And again, it corresponds to frequency. So if we look at the figures from some corpus, this is from Jaeger 2007, we see that patients tend to be indefinite, they tend to be inanimate, they tend to be third person, and they tend to be noun phrases as opposed to pronouns. And the pronoun patients are rarer, the first, second person patients are rarer, the animate patients are rarer, also the definite patients are rarer. So with definite, it's sort of about equal. But when compared to the agents, there's kind of really a striking difference between, because with agents, it's sort of the opposite. Agents tend to be pronouns and are much less rarely full and piece. They tend to be first, second person, are more rarely third person. They tend to be animate, are more rarely inanimate, and they strongly tend to be definite and are more rarely indefinite. So patients and agents are rather different with respect to these factors of salience, definiteness, animacy, person, and also pronoun versus full NP. So it's these frequency asymmetries which I would argue give rise to the grammatical marking, and which lead to this pattern where there's a kind of clear correlation between the salience, or I put it here, the definiteness scale and the animacy scale. And sometimes people have said, well, what is the relationship between definiteness and animacy? It's, you know, they come up with this very general notion of salience, or sometimes individuation or empathy or so, or just prominence. It doesn't matter much. We don't really need some kind of semantic or pragmatic cover term, because it all boils down to frequency of use, I would argue. So languages tend to have overt accusative coding for the rarer kinds of patients, just as they have overt coding for the rarer number and the rarer core argument, accusative nominative. So so that's the claim. And whatever is cross-linguistically really general and thoroughgoing seems to boil down to this cross-linguistic trend for simply talking about different things with different frequencies. Okay. So now stepping back a little bit, talking about frequency and the general notion of code efficiency. So if we think of language as an instrument, you know, we wonder how efficient it is. And it, ideally, it should be efficient, just like any other instrument should be efficient. And if speakers have the possibility of managing the instrument a little bit, you know, just like somebody who works with an instrument like a hammer or so. If the hammer doesn't work properly, they can adjust it, you know, modify it, or, well, make a new one. You know, we cannot make a new language easily, but we can adjust and modify our language a little bit. So our language should be an efficient code. It should be both parsimonious and distinctive. These are the requirements, because the language should serve both the needs of the speaker and of the hearer. What is the speaker's need? The speaker's need is that the language system should be economical on encoding energy. We shouldn't waste unnecessary effort. It should also be distinctive. It should minimize the decoding effort of the hearer. So it should be a good compromise between speaker's needs and hearer's needs. It should be both speaker-friendly and hearer-friendly, ideally, in the ideal case. So let's look at two hypothetical codes, one that's maximally parsimonious but not distinctive. So, you know, if you say the dog chases the cat, you can just say chase, dog, cat, and then maybe the word order will give you who does what to whom. So it's maximally parsimonious. Or I'll buy a flower for my wife, and you don't say how many flowers and how many wives. On the other hand, if you want to be maximally distinctive, so if you put an agent marker here, a kind of nominative, an overt patient marker here, an overt plural marker here, an overt singular marker here, then you get a system that is maximally distinctive. So it's very good, the hearer gets all the information. But it's not parsimonious, because the speaker has to add these four additional morphemes. So these types of systems are both good on one point, but not so good on the other. They're not kind of not distinctive, not parsimonious. But then, such is life, right? You cannot have everything. So, you know, it may be indeed that some languages are more speaker-friendly, other languages are more hearer-friendly. I mean, that's certainly a possibility, right? We can't exclude that, or at least that some constructions are more speaker-friendly, other constructions are more speaker-friendly. Linguists don't generally talk in these terms, but I think it's not absurd. One could imagine that is the case. Certainly, certain orthographies, for example, can be talked about in this way, right? So Chinese orthography, for example, is known to be reader-friendly. Once you've learned it, you know, you can read Chinese much faster than you can read English or Czech, but it's not learner-friendly. So, you know, sometimes sign systems have different advantages. Also, Chinese used to be rather writer unfriendly. So, you know, you had to write all these strokes very carefully. Nowadays, with computers, Chinese has become much more writer friendly. It's much easier also to write Chinese. It may still be a bit more cumbersome to write Chinese. I don't know of any studies. But anyway, orthographies, clearly, some are more reader friendly and some are more writer or learner friendly. What I think is the case with languages is that generally they're kind of compromise between the speaker's needs and the hearer's needs, and they're an efficient compromise. So code efficiency can be achieved by exploiting paradigmatic organization. Only one member of binary opposition needs to be coded. If the coding is obligatory, then you automatically know that the other member that doesn't have overt coding has this other meaning, right? So if plural is obligatory, then if there's no plural marker, you know it must be a singular. So, and in this way, you kind of achieve both. You have the marking where it's needed, and you don't have the marking where it's not so needed, namely because of the frequency asymmetry. The more frequent member of a binary opposition is zero coded, the rarer member is overtly coded, and that is generally the most efficient way of organizing a sign system. And I think that system is also exploited in many other cases of sign systems. So, for example, an example that I like to give is that of phone numbers. When you make a call within your city, you don't have to give the additional number, or within your country, you don't have to give the country code, and so on, because most of the time you call within the country. So it's really very general system applying to all codes, and human languages are just normal cases of this. But it's not just the zero overt contrast, it's also the short versus long contrast that we sometimes find. So if we look at singular versus plural versus dual, then often what we have is that the dual is still longer than the plural. So in Hebrew, yom is day, yamim is days, with the plural makaim, and then 2 days is yomayim. So that's an even longer marker. Or in Chanti, that's the Finno-Ugric language of Russia, chot is house, chotet is houses, and chot ngan, using an additional segment, is 2 houses. Or maybe with cases, Hungarian, hajó, the nominative, I think it means house, hajót is the accusative, and the dative, hajónak, an additional segment. Or in English you could say nominative, accusative, dative is a preposition, it consists of 2 segments, so it's still longer than the accusative. So by and large, this applies also if you have ternary oppositions, not just these binary opposition as we saw between singular and plural. And as I said, human languages are not always maximally efficient. So you do get things like the singular plural both being marked kniga, knigi, or as in Mandarin Chinese, it's neither singular nor plural that's marked. Or we get this nominative and accusative being both marked, or as in Mandarin Chinese, neither singular nor plural being marked. What we don't get is an anti-efficient language, one that's really bad both for speakers and for hearers, right? That's really excluded, or it should arise only under very exceptional circumstances, and it should be very rare and should be really prone to elimination. So I call this Martian here. So assuming that perhaps there are Martians, and the Martians have a language that is not subject to our terrestrial constraints of efficiency, which is unlikely because the efficiency effects are extremely broad. But let's just assume, there are these Martians and they can be very inefficient, and so they have the singular kniga and the plural knig, or the nominative hajón and the accusative hajó. So that is something that's predicted to be very rare on Earth, at least on Mars. It may be more frequent. So the foundation for this was laid in Greenberg, 1966, and then Bill Croft in 1990 also wrote about it. And I hope that in the future more and more people will realize the scope of this, because it's not just singular, plural, nominative, accusative. It's really everything in grammar. It's active versus passive, or it's direct versus oblique marking, or it's subjunctive versus indicative. It's all kinds of asymmetries are found in language after language in much the same way, and it has to do with the fact that they're found in language after language with different frequencies. Okay, so after we've seen these synchronic frequencies, what is the connection to actually shaping the language? How does the language system come about? We said earlier intelligent design is not really a possibility. We cannot say that the English language was created as such by a benevolent creator who thought the English-speaking people should have a nice, efficient language. No, it has to be the speakers that somehow negotiated in some kind of evolutionary process, as I mentioned earlier. So how do these frequency asymmetries lead to the coding asymmetries? How, what is the causal relationship or the diachronic implementation of these tendencies? And here I think we can refer to John Bybee's work on frequency effects, in particular the conserving effect and the reducing effect. But I will argue that there's also another effect that John Bybee hasn't talked so much about. So John Bybee has noted that repetition strengthens memory representation for linguistic forms and makes them more accessible. So frequent forms resist analogical change, for example. So we have keep kept, and kept is not replaced by kept, or sleep slept. Slept is not replaced by sleep because slept is very frequent. Every morning you say, I slept well, or I slept not so well, or whatever. Whereas weep, wept, that's not so frequent, especially nowadays when mostly says cry for weeping. So people replace wept by weeped, or leap leapt. That's another verb that's not so frequent anymore. It used to mean the same as jump. Nowadays, jump has taken over much of leap. So we say also leap leaped, or creep crept is replaced by creep creeped. So there are many examples of this in any Indo-European language. I think you know, if you study, you know, a little bit about the history of Czech, you probably know that there are some regularizations of irregular inflection patterns, stem changes, and so on. Or maybe in the colloquial language, or you know, sometimes in children's speech or so, we find these regularizations. The frequent forms also tend to be the basis of analogical change. So weep, wept is replaced by weep, weeped, but not by wept, wept, because weep is more frequent. And also frequent forms, this is the most important in the current context, they resist innovative constructions. So I know not, that was the earlier English form, is replaced by I do not know. I see not is replaced by I do not see. But I am not is not replaced by I do not be. Or I may not is not replaced by I do not may. Why is that? It has to do with frequency. These are highly frequent and are therefore more resistant to the extension of this change. Now then there's also the reducing effect. This is something that John Bybee has stressed, especially reductive sound change affects high frequency items more quickly and more radically than low frequency items. So I am becomes I'm, I have becomes I've, they are not becomes they aren't. But these shortenings are only used with really high frequency items. So if you say something like I ate or so, or I, what other words are they beginning with a? I asked, for example, right? You know, I asked cannot be reduced to asked. You know, it's phonologically, it's not that different, but it clearly has to do with frequency. This is also nicely seen in the German preposition article combination. So zu dem becomes zum, in dem becomes im. But in the plural, for example, zu den, that would be the plural of dem, zu den is not reduced to zun. And that's again because the plural is not as frequent as a singular. Or in Latin, the habeo, the have verb, is reduced quite drastically. So, you know, we find this again and again in languages that these high frequency items undergo stronger changes. This is something that when you read the literature on historic linguistics in the 20th century, many people missed, because the neo-grammarians insisted on the regularity of sound change. They were so happy that they had discovered this as a principle, and they didn't really want to accept random exceptions due to frequency. So they were often trying to argue that something else was happening, you know, some kind of special analogy or so. But I think the evidence for this kind of change is really quite overwhelming. Okay, then I skip the autonomy effect and the productivity effect, because they're not so important here. And I get to this other effect that I want to add a bit later. So the question is, how do we get short or zero singulars, and how do we get short or zero nominatives? So how do speakers shape their language in such a way that that happens? So I think sometimes, indeed, singulars become shorter because they're more frequent because of special phonological reduction. At least this is the impression that you get when you read the historical linguistics literature. So in Proto-Germanic, the word for day is reconstructed as dags, and for days is reconstructed as dagos. That's following the Gothic paradigm, where you still have this S here in the nominative singular. Now, in Old English, already, you have day for the nominative singular and dagas for the nominative plural. So what happened to this S here in Old English? What you find in the handbooks is they say there is special final sound laws of what happens to final position, Auslautgesetze, as is in German. I don't even know how that would be in English. Auslaut laws, special developments in final position. But there's really no reason why you should get these special developments. So I think it has to do with frequency, that these affixes tend to be more frequent. But I would have to argue this specifically. So this is just a suggestion here. So getting to Slavic here in the third person singular, we have an interesting development that third person singular, which sort of generally there's a general tendency for third person singular to be zero because it's the most frequent of the persons. In Proto-Slavic, there was an overt marker in all the persons. In Russian, that's still the case. In Russian, it's pishu, pishish, pishit. But in Polish, and is Czech similar to Polish here? So it's also dropped the T, right? So that's perhaps the general West Slavic development. So what happened to this T? Maybe some of you are experts in what the historical Slavic linguists say, but I think they generally don't have a clue. There's no special Auslautgesetz, no special law for why the T should be dropped, because normally the T, there was a vowel after this in Proto-Slavic. So, okay, this vowel is dropped, that's regular, that's one of the years. But why is the T dropped? That's certainly not regular. The word for cat, for example, that's kot in Russian. That also has a T in Czech, right? I don't know. So, you're an expert.
I'm not an expert, but a common explanation given to our students usually,
yeah,
in morphology classes, mm-hmm, is that it's a matter of oppositions. There are three forms in singular and three forms in plural. So, the first person is marked by the ending, the second person is marked by an ending. So, the third person doesn't need an ending. It's sufficiently marked by the zero.
Right, so that's quite compatible with what I'm saying.
Oh, yes, but there is no special phonological process, I think.
Right, okay.
It was lost because it wasn't necessary.
Okay, I think that's actually the same as I'm saying, except that there's no explanation for why, for example, it's not the second person that dropped, right? Why didn't the sh drop? Right. If it's just a matter of opposition, you could say, okay, you have a marker in the first person. Does Czech have the M here? Right. The M was extended, not in this word, perhaps. Right. But so there's a marker for the first person singular, a third person singular, and then the second person can be zero. Right. So that would be possible as well. But why is it the third person? Because it's the most frequent one.
And in the first person and the second
Well, it's the third person can be combined. But does it? I thought it doesn't. I thought it doesn't need. I think, you know, I don't know about Czech. I studied some Polish. I know in Polish you can say pisze or piszesz or pisze, and you don't need to say on pisze in Polish. You can just say pisze, right? At least standard Czech is probably like that as well. Yeah, yeah. So you know, actually Czech is very normal in that respect. You know, the languages that are special are English and German. These are really strange languages. Most languages are like Czech. You know, when you have person inflection for the subject on the verb, then you don't need a pronoun subject. And most languages are like Czech in that the third person singular doesn't have an overt marker, simply because it's the most frequent one.
Yeah. My question would be different. Do you expect that in Old Slavic the frequency was different? Or how did the T at all got there that it had to disappear later on?
Yeah, that's a very good question. So do I argue that in those languages, when there's an overt marker, that there's, you know, what is the other force, right? That does not lead to this. So the general answer is, you know, there's the hearer friendliness and the speaker friendliness. Now, of course, it's hearer friendly if you tell them this is a third person form. It's speaker friendly if you don't tell the hearer anything, basically, right? And what I'm arguing is that the best compromise is the speaker doesn't say anything for the most frequent forms and informs the hearer only for the less frequent forms. So sometimes languages are, you know, they code everything. They also code the third person form. You know, just like some languages also code the nominative, or some languages also code the singular. So sometimes you have overt singular markers. So these are the languages or the constructions which are then particularly hearer-friendly, right? You know, I gave an example of this earlier, right? So these cases are really non-efficient. They're not fully efficient. They are the kniga, knigi, you know, both have a marker, both the singular and the plural, on both the nominative and the accusative. So, you know, Old Slavic is similar. Here, it has a marker in all three persons, and that's not the full efficiency is not exploited, but it's hearer friendly. And similarly, a language like Swedish, for example, which has no person marking, well, that's not so good for the hearer, but it's very good for the speaker then. Now, of course, Swedish then has these obligatory personal pronouns. Yeah.
I have a commentary about your question why the ending is lost in the third person and not in second. I don't know about Polish, but I'm quite sure that in Czech the third person was used to address the second person as well, onikani, so-called. Mm-hmm. So maybe that could be one reason. It's just, you know, a commentary.
It's perhaps one of the factors that leads to the greater frequency mm-hmm. of the third person, and it's also referred for the second person. But actually, I don't think that's kind of been so relevant, because this was used only in special circumstances. So when you address somebody from the nobility or so, you know, the kind of the really spread of these politeness features that happened only in the 19th century or so. Before the 19th century, you would refer to someone as pan or pani, using the Polish forms now, only if they are from the nobility. So in everyday life, it played very little role. So I don't think it can have been so relevant, because these changes are much earlier. You know, they're 1,000 years old or older, actually. And at the time, there was no nobility to speak of, and no influence of the feudal system. And any event, the opportunity for the poor people to speak to the nobles was very rare and unusual. And So, but it's still interesting to ask whether we find tendencies nowadays that these politeness forms have become so frequent that they affect the language somehow, right? That is certainly an interesting question to ask. Of course, there are some languages where the politeness forms have taken over completely, like in English, where the you form, which originally was a polite form, has taken over completely. So, the English you form has led to some confusion because in the system, because now there's no good singular plural contrast for the second person. So you can be used both for the Slavic T and for the Slavic V. So English speakers sometimes seem to be uncomfortable with this, and so they add a special plural form and they say you guys, as you probably know from American movies or so. Or in the south of the United States, people say you all, or they abbreviate it to y'all. And it's interesting that it's the plural form that gets a special marker, right? It's not the singular form. It's not you versus you guy or you girl or whatever. It's the plural that gets the special marker. And this is what I talk about here as the expectation generating effect. So high frequency leads to a high degree of expectedness, and it is only for the rarer meanings that the expectation needs to be countered, for example, by introducing further marking. So consider a language without plural marking, Proto-Melanesian Pidgin House. So in this pidgin, spoken in New Guinea and adjacent island, the English plural marking had gotten lost. So they only had house. Now in modern talk Pisin, there's a contrast between the singular house and the plural all house. That comes from all houses. And that is completely parallel to the use of y'all or you guys in American English for the V plural. So here it's a singular meaning that's expected due to frequency, so an overt marker is only introduced for plural meaning. So expectations need to be countered only for the rarer meanings. Speakers behave economically when introducing innovations. So the same explanation may also apply in some of the other cases where we have an asymmetry where quite clearly the zero is the old form and the additional marker is a fairly recent new form. So we have the Spanish accusative marker, I see Juan, it's veo a Juan, and this a may have been introduced because the expectation is if you hear Juan, well, probably it's a nominative. So you have to kind of counter this expectation and then put this additional and this expectation generating effect is not found in John Bybee's work on frequency, and I think that's really a very serious omission because she seems to think that frequency is sort of only something that's affects the speaker. She has this nice quotation here. Phonetic reduction is directly tied to neuromotor processing. Repeated sequences of neuromotor commands and actions tend to be processed as single units. At the same time, repeated sequences tend to become more efficient by the increased overlap and reduction of the gestures involved. So certainly, when you do something again and again and again, it becomes routinized. You do it more easily and more fluently. I heard her talk about this way back in the late 1980s when she was going back to trying to play the piano, and she says, I know it from piano playing. The more frequently I practice something, the more fluent my performances get. This is a very general cognitive principle and also applies to language, of course. But then my question is fluency really the same as reduction? And I don't think it is, because while you may sort of play very slowly, when your finger movements are not very fluent yet, you will not normally reduce your play once you're very quick, right? When you can play very quickly and fluently, you know, maybe if you sort of, you know, as a joke, you know, try to make a contest who can play Für Elisa in the fastest way or whatever, and then you will omit some notes. But normally, you will just play the whole piece, playing every note, because you don't want to deprive the listener of the nice music. In language, it's rather different, because we have all this reduction that is due to the predictability by the hearer. It's because the hearer can predict some things that I can omit things. In music, predictability plays no role. So I think what you find in Joan Bibi's work, even though her work is perhaps the most widely cited for the usage frequency account, and it's influenced me a lot. So the reason why I go around and talk about frequency is that I've been influenced by Joan Bibi. I was an exchange student in the late 1980s in the United States, and I worked with Joan Bibi. So I think she's a great linguist, but she has not sufficiently taken into account the role of the hearer. So this reducing effect certainly is there. I think you can also find it in contrast between alienable and inalienable possessions. So in Italian, we have, especially in some dialects and in Old Italian, especially reduced personal pronoun for kinship terms. But this cannot be used for alienable possession, so for things that are not kinship terms. So the idea is with kinship terms, the use of a person of possessive pronouns is much more frequent. It's reduced, or it's sort of very clear with the English wanna versus wanto. This has been also quite widely discussed by syntacticians. You can say the reason I want to come is Anna. I wanna is a frequent colloquial reduction in English, but you cannot say the guest I want to come is Anna. And some syntacticians have made a big deal out of this and have said, yeah, well, that's because there's a trace in there here between want and to, and there's no trace here. But I think it can simply be explained by frequency. Here, the kind of combination is highly frequent, whereas here, the combination is quite rare. Okay, then I have some discussion here about the conserving effect, but I'm actually not sure. This is the role of the conserving effect versus the expectation generating effect is not so clear to me, so I don't want to go into details here. I think in general expectation is very important because it's because of the expectations that you can reduce a form, and the frequency is not the direct cause of the reduction. It's because of high expectations. You sometimes in language also have zero forms which are not due to frequency, but due to contextual expectation, right? When you have ellipses, for example. These are different things. They are special contextual forms, but the use of zero due to expectation is really very, very general in the language system, and it's currently underappreciated by theoretical morphosyntacticians. Okay, so to summarize, here's a little picture from a nice paper by Paul Kiparski. Paul Kiparski recognizes that in a 2008 paper that typological generalizations may be due to language change, which are due to universals of language use. He has the example of simple versus complex anaphores, and maybe also the difference between singulars and plural and so on. So this B part, that's the explanation for cross-linguistic generalizations that I would advocate. And that, I think, has very wide applicability. Now, Kiparsky, in his 2008 paper, tries to argue that there's also a second set of generalizations, and these he calls the true universals, and they are directly due to language acquisition. So they're not due to language change. And universal grammar, of course, it is what constrains acquisition. And then acquisition may again have some influence on language use and language change and so on. So this paper from 2008 is really, you know, the best paper on these kinds of questions by a generative linguist that I've seen. You know, if we go back to my first page, remember, I said language structure is all three. It's a coherent, abstract system on the structuralist mode. It's constrained by the properties of the innate language faculty, so that is Kiparsky's A, and it's shaped by the needs of language use in diachronic change, that's B. So I think all three factors are relevant, and we have to try and find out what the role of these three factors is. And Kiparsky, in this 2008 article, says, well, some universals are due to this, and some are due to this, and he tries to find criteria for which is which. So he says, for example, differential case marking is a universal that's due to universal grammar, but simple versus complex anaphors is a universal that's due to language change. And one of his criteria is whether you find exceptions. So he says the change type universals sometimes have exceptions. So for the simple and complex anaphors, he gives some examples of exceptions, I think. For differential case marking, he claims there are no exceptions. But of course, there are exceptions. So he didn't know about this paper by Filimonova. It's a 2005 paper, The Noun Phrase Hierarchy and Relational Marking Problems and Counter-Evidence. You know, it's not really counter-evidence that she cites. It's counter-evidence only to the claim that there are no exceptions. But, you know, on the B scenario here, you know, the occasional exceptions would be expected. So it's just, you know, listing some exceptions to be clear that, well, yes, occasionally languages do strange things and we cannot explain everything. What we can explain is the general and strong trends so I think at least this particular instance that Kiparsky cites is also in category B. And I think actually most interesting cross-linguistic generalizations are in category B. So, I mean, there is quite possibly something here, but I focus on this. And if somebody has a good case of generalization that can be explained by universal grammar and by constraints on acquisition, I'd be happy to look at it. And if I'm convinced, then I'll say, fine, that's due to universal grammar. But I think there's much more potential for explanation in the second approach. Okay, so section five, he just summarizes again. And then talks a little bit about what exactly is an explanation. So these frequency form correlations that I talked about clearly do not hold at the level of the individual language system. The language system itself is independent of usage frequency. So Searle and Chomsky are right in that. You know, it's not that our system is kind of directly linked to the usage system. These usage frequency effects are not synchronic effects, they're diachronic effects. Over time, it's practically inevitable that language change brings frequency and form into equilibrium. But this can take a long time, and it can be counteracted by social forces. So, you know, this the creation of the you guys plural in English, that's frowned upon. So if you sit in an American school and you write you guys, and your teacher will cross out the guys and will say, that's colloquial, you're not supposed to write that, right? And then some people may say, oh, okay, that's bad English, so, and then they will even in speech perhaps say you for the plural. So these forces, they're sometimes there, and you know, you have to take them into account, and similar forces of conservatism are quite strong everywhere. Now, in principle, one would need to know the frequency of a pattern at the time when it arose in order to explain its properties through usage frequency. So, you know, in order to know whether this old Slavic pishetu, pisheshi form and so on, you would have to know what the frequency was at that time. In practice, of course, that's impossible. We don't have ancient corpora. We don't even have good modern corpora. But many of these form asymmetries are universal. Many frequency asymmetries are also universal. So if we demonstrate that the form asymmetry is universal, at least there's a strong tendency, and that reflects a universal frequency asymmetry, then we have strong evidence for a frequency-based explanation. So this is the approach that I've generally adopted, right? I talked about these universal asymmetries starting with Greenberg. So in this sense, then, explanation consists of explanations of universals, and language-particular phenomena are only explained in a weak sense, if they instantiate the universal tendencies. So we can say that, you know, whenever a language conforms to this, so has a third-person singular zero, like Czech, then, you know, in a weak sense, it's explained because it's part of a bigger picture. So, you know, when we look at some asymmetries of marking, in English, for example, then some can be explained in a weak sense, others cannot. And in order to know that, we have to know which of these are instantiations of general trends. So a book of mine versus the book of mine. You know, that sounds really strange. Sing-sang versus bring-brang. You know, why can't you say bring-brang? I saw you, but you can't say you saw you. I'm interested in the picture, I'm surprised in the picture. Who said what? What did who say? Is impossible. Book books, but not stare, stairs. Well, a stare, well, maybe that is possible actually in English, but it's kind of unusual. Anyway, so we have these contrasts, and some of them are clearly language particular. Right? So I think four out of these six can be explained in a weak sense. Which are the ones that can't be explained? Bring, brang, sing, sang. It's just idiosyncratic. There's no general tendency that the word for bring should be kind of non-ablauting and the word for sing should be ablauting. Or interested in the picture, surprised in the picture, surprised by the picture. You know, no general tendency for interest word and surprise word to have different prepositions. So 26 and 28 are not instances of general trends. The others, I think, are instances of general trends, but it's not so easy to show, you know, especially 29A and B, that hasn't been studied for so many languages. but in particular, the I saw you versus you saw you, that's been studied very widely in lots and lots and lots of languages. For reflexive use, you need a special reflexive pronoun. So it's a very general trend, and there's a good frequency-based explanation for that, because you know, simply having disjoint subject and object is much more frequent than having semantically co-referential subject and object. Okay, I have another section, but maybe I stop at this point to leave some time for more general questions that you might have.
So you may have some burning questions, and it was never the right time to ask, or you thought you didn't want to interrupt me. So this would be a possibility.
If I may, you come to just the nominative form of singular and plural in the corpora data. I mean, because I think it's more complex when you see some, for example, the kniga and knigi as nominative and accusative, then, for example, in Czech there is genitive in plural, which is not marked. So it's shorter than the nominative singular. And why is that? Whereas I think that the nominative singular is more frequent than genitive plural, and there is kniha, but knih without ending in the genitive. So I think this is an example for the opposite direction. Yeah. Or for example, in the Latin, there you had Marcus and Marcum, but yeah. There's also other cases which are shorter, like dative or locative.
Marcum, Marque. Yeah, the vocative is short.
Because it's
dative in Latin is not short because it has a long vowel, Marco. So it's strictly if you count the segments. But a long vowel should perhaps count, so it's not a very strict count example. But these things really would have to be looked at, statistically. And the Slavic genitive plural is a famous case that nobody can explain well. And I think that's good because it really is very idiosyncratic. You know, there's no tendency whatsoever for languages to have zero in the genitive plural. It's just at some point in Slavic this was developed, and in Slavic declension patterns are generally quite conservative. It's a case like the interested in, surprised in, or sin, san, bring, brand. It's certainly unexpected, and it's an exception to the trend, but it doesn't worry me so much. Because I look at the bigger picture, and for the bigger picture, it's really strange. It's very prominent, of course, especially if you study a Slavic language. But also English has some of these strange things. You know, we saw earlier the third person singular has a tendency to be zero mark. Now in English, it's the opposite. In English, it's a third person singular marker that has an overt form. And if you want to understand English, then of course you want to have some rationale for that. You know, you it cries out for some explanation. But I think there is none. It's just strange. Some things are weird and they don't worry me so much because there's no general tendency. The general tendency, by contrast, is in the opposite direction. We see some English dialects which also found this strange, and they have a rather different rule. So if you know a little bit about English dialectology, Jeffrey can probably confirm that, there's a northern subject rule, right? Which has kind of reorganized the system in a quite radical way. And also some Slavic languages, in particular Serbo-Croatian, has done something to the genitive plural. But yeah, Czech and also Polish and Russian are quite conservative. And they just preserve this quirk over the generations. Sorry, I can't say anything about it. Yes, please.
May I go back to my first question in verbs?
Yeah.
Because, well, I thought that, from semantic point of view, the first person singular is always the speaker. And everybody knows in the situation who the speaker is. So it's marked by on the verb. And you know the gender of the speaker, everything you need in communication. It's the same for the second person, the addressee. But if you have the third person, something that is spoken about, you would expect to know whether it's he or she, whether it's a thing. And this is what the subject tells you, so you would expect somewhere in the context to have a subject, like this book is about English or something like that, and this having a subject which marks, for example, the gender, could maybe explain why you don't need the gender and morphology on the verb, why you don't need a special marking.
Yeah, I don't know. I mean, these things would have to be done in a very rigorous way. I mean, what you said, actually, that can be taken to argue in both directions. You could say, for the third person, you need more information, because it's not so obvious.
Yeah.
First and the second person is more obvious from the context.
Yeah.
So in a way, you could say, based on contextual information, that you don't need information about first and second person at all. Whereas third person, always some information is needed, and therefore you would expect first and second person to be zero and third person to be overtly marked. So yeah, actually, but as far as the person is concerned, I'm not so sure. I'm a bit hesitant, and I would need to do more research on this. One particular problem is that the frequency of use cannot be investigated so much, because all our corpora are biased toward third person, because either they're written corpora, and then they contain sort of a lot of talk about other people. They're not corpora of the colloquial speech. But even if they are colloquial speech, then they are they tend to be, conversations about innocuous topics and so on. They're not the kind of conversations that we have really in everyday use. And I think the grammar, the hardcore grammar, is shaped by the kind of conversations that you have over breakfast, or that you have, one speaker is in the shower, the other speaker is somewhere else. You know, these kinds of conversations, you can't record them. You don't really know what's going on. So I'm not sure. I think more research is needed there. But you were not really arguing against me, right? You were trying to help me, or?
I'm not trying to fight with you. I'm not here to fight with you.
Yeah.
But, well, because in Czech and in other Slavic languages, the markers of morphology usually have more than one function. That's one thing. So, Píšu is both a present tense and first person singular and stuff. So this is one thing that may play some role. Then, even if you are reading a text and the author says, well, I think, and you read the sentence, I think that this is the case of something, you always tend to say, okay, so I think in this context is the author who wrote the book, so you don't really need to have a conversation like face to face, because this dialectical property of first person and second person is used in both spoken and written corpora.
Okay, thank you. I think we need to stop now. Okay, so we'll continue in the afternoon.
Yes.